Sasset Dizian Chanel Way. And today, we are going to be talking about five things that are scarier than mermaids. Now, I was just gonna do another mermaid video, but I saw a lot of you guys like,
oh my god, I'm never going in the water. Oh my god, mermaids are so terrifying.
But like, you know what? Have y'all ever heard of all the crazy things we got on land, bruh? A lot of these have been traditional stories and myths and stuff, but there's actually been a lot of evidence and eyewitnesses that actually corroborate with a lot of these beings or creatures actually existing. Buckle up! It might be a little scary, but I'm gonna try to tone it down because last time y'all wanted to be little fucking crybabies or whatever. And if you guys like this video, I'll most likely do individual videos about some of these creatures. These things are so fucking interesting. I have so much notes. This is going to be the start of my fact or fantasy series, okay? Without further ado, let's get started. First creature on my list is the El Chupacabra. Now, if you guys never heard about it, woo child, it's a lot. This actually has to be one of the first like mythical, traditional type of legend creatures that I've heard of in Latin or South America. I used to watch so many documentaries on it because I've always found it extremely interesting. Back in the mid to late 90s, there was a woman named Madeline Tolentino. Listen, if you guys haven't been here before, just understand that I'm very, very bad at pronouncing things. And I butcher shit a lot. I'm very, very sorry. I mean, absolutely no disrespect. And essentially, she saw the El Chupacabra outside of her window. Now, if you guys are trying to understand where the name comes from, chupe means to suck, cabra means goat, and the American translation of the El Chupacabra is the goat sucker or the blood-sucking goat. People who have reported seeing it have said that it's like really, really big, and it kind of looks like a kangaroo almost, spikes along its back, red eyes, skinless, like literally just very scary shit. And throughout the 90s, when this started getting reported, the Chupacabra was literally blamed for killing all types of cattle, attacking little small domestic animals like cats and dogs, especially those that resided on farms. And it got to the point where like other people in other regions of the world started reporting other types of El Chupacabras, or like smaller, like skinless, but like dog looking, but they had like red eyes and they looked extremely scary, and they were also going around killing cattle and domestic animals. Now, you guys are probably sitting there like, you know, it could have been anything. It could have been a wolf, it could have been this, could have been that. And to be quite honest with you, you might be right, because there were lots of scientists and lots of other, you know, professionals that came together and came to the conclusion that these people were seeing dogs or animals that had mangy. I don't know. I feel like mangy is the right term, because we've all heard of the term of a mangy dog. You know, oh my god, get that mangy dog away from me. And you know, they always look really, really scary. But for the most part, we could all tell that they're dogs. The only problem with this theory is that essentially a lot of these people that would like shoot the El Chupacabras or see these El Chupacabras were like skilled people. These were like hunters. These are people that lived on farms. These are people that are with animals all of the time. So how would they not be able to differentiate El Chupacabra from a mangy dog? You know, it's very interesting. But they did find bodies. They did have bodies, because like I said, people were shooting them, killing them, doing all this extra shit. And they did run tests, and that's what they came out to be. But it could also be like, how about if the El Chupacabras are just part dog, part some shit? Like, that's extremely possible. So, what do you think? Real or not? Next is the Lugawu, the Lupgawu, the Rugawu. I've made a dedicated video about this because, y'all, there's a lot that goes into that. And essentially, a lot of you guys may see this as equivalent to a skinwalker, a shapeshifter. There's lots of different like American type of similarities or translations to what a Lugawu or Rugawu is. But essentially, a Lugawu can be anything, but it's essentially described as someone that can go from one extreme to the next in terms of being an animal and being a human, and they consume blood in order to stay alive and retain their energy. They're kind of like a werewolf and a vampire in the same sense. It's very hard to explain, but just know that if you ever come across one, you don't really want to be near them. Now, in the Haitian voodoo culture particularly, one is usually turned into a Lugawu if they are bad people. You know, if they've done something very bad, if they pissed off a mumbo or ogon, which is essentially a voodoo priest or a voodoo priestess, usually these people are turned into Lugawus, or whatever it is, you know, committing murder. Like, there's a lot of different things that can make you become a lugawu. Sometimes it's punishment for using voodoo for bad. A lot of people have a common misconception that Haitian voodoo or voodoo in itself is just inherently a bad religion, when in actuality is a religion that has a lot of bad people practicing it that use it in conjunction with black magic and other things to do harm to others. For any of you guys who know anything about, you know, these types of practices, if you do anything with ill intent or bad emotion behind it, it will flip back onto you, and shit gets flipped back onto them. They turn into lugawus. There's other things as well, and in Haiti, most of the time, a lot of babies actually die at the hand of lugawus. Lugawus love to kill babies. They suck their blood. They have been known to kidnap babies, hence why you would see a lot of people don't really bring their super young or super small children to Haiti, because they're really afraid of lugawus. This is a very genuine concern, and it's always been a concern forever. Like, I had to wait to go to Haiti for the first time when I was like 7 or 8 because my parents were afraid a lugawu would eat me. I have friends that, you know, claim that their siblings have been eaten by lugawus when they were smaller. How do they kill them, you ask? A lugawu goes and strikes the kid with a fever most of the time, or some sort of sickness, and usually it's hard to even determine what's wrong. Usually the kid will just fall sick out of nowhere, and usually the lugawu will kidnap the baby then and there, but sometimes they'll wait till the baby is like legitimately buried, dig the baby up, and do whatever it is that they want to do with the baby. Very scary shit, and it's very interesting because, as crazy as this sounds, there's been numerous stories and reports of people actually seeing lugawu, killing lugawu, and all types of shit. Like I said, they have two skins. You know, usually they're like a wolf or a bird of some sort. However, in the daytime, they look like just you and me. There's been people who have said they've been married to a lugawu and didn't even know it. And y'all, I'm telling you, it sounds wicked, but honestly, it might just be. Comment down below. Do you believe it? Or do you not? I've heard of numerous stories of like people getting killed because they were suspected of being lugawus in their neighborhoods, and kids started turning up missing and all types of crazy shit. Like, honestly, this may be extremely ignorant or extremely just detrimental. This whole thing reminds me all the time of this story regarding 3 blind women from Levesque in Haiti who were killed because they were suspected of being lugawu. We had Vanessa, Monique, and Jizila, who went out to Port-au-Prince, which is the Haiti of capital, just to get some supplies. On their way there, or on their way back, some way, somehow, they were ambushed, killed. They were beaten, stabbed, found in a ditch with their tongues cut off. Now, this entire story happened in 2016, so keep that in mind. Now, what's really fucked up about all of this is that all 3 women were... Sorry guys, I made a little mistake right here in the video. I kept saying that the women were blind, but instead they were actually deaf. Levesque is a part of Haiti that has been set up as a safe haven for those who are deaf in Haiti. Now, what's really messed up in Haiti and many other foreign countries, those with disabilities are often attacked and castigated and often seen as devil worshipers, or seen to have followed some sort of, you know, horrible traditions and or beliefs in order to lead them to those misfortunes in life. So this whole situation prompted a huge civil rights type of situation. It was really, really bad. Lots of people were protesting. People were outraged because these women literally lost their lives for no reason. A lot of people don't really know exactly what happened that night, but it is believed that since the women were deaf, on their way back from Port-au-Prince back to Levesque, they weren't able to hear the news that one of the bridges had collapsed on their way back home. So while they were in one of the top tops, which is like kind of like a local taxi type Jeep situation, they were in traffic. It was getting late, so they decided to stay nearby at one of their relatives' houses. One of the girls had relatives that lived in the area that had a house, and they were like, you know what, we're just gonna stay there and then we're gonna go home in the morning. Essentially, this is nighttime, and if you haven't watched my videos before and you don't know anything about Haiti or most foreign places, you cannot just be popping up anywhere at night. One relative of the girl, one of the girls at least, because it was her relative's spot, you get the point, had been there before, but like I said, it's nighttime, and you know, they were growing suspicious. They saw them, they were like, uh-uh, like they might be some lugawu. Essentially, they tortured them, murdered them, and yeah, really sad shit. As real as I believe Lugaos are, I don't think it justifies people just randomly killing people because they suspect them of being Lugaos. At least catch a motherfucker first. It is extremely difficult to kill a Lugao in its transformed state. You have to kill a Lugao when they're in their human state because they're incredibly strong. And for the most part, they're incredibly huge. Like, let's be real here. Who's gonna win? A Lugao or a human? Like, realistically, you are always supposed to kill them that way. There's lots of other things you can do, like laying out salt and all of this extra stuff so they can't get back into your skin, so you can kind of catch them and act. But again, it's easier just to kill them as a human. What's really worse is during the earthquake, they saw a huge height of people like being real ignorant and just killing people for absolutely no reason, you know, suspecting them as being Lugao. It was like, listen, the Lugao situation is essentially a pandemic over there in Haiti. And I know that lots of other voodoo cultures have them as well. Scarier is actually mermaids have been connected to be like some sort of water Lugaos, especially the ugly ones that we always talk about all the time in these videos. Let me know what you think down below, because I'd love to hear your thoughts and opinions on that. Next, we have the Loch Ness Monster. The Loch Ness Monster has been a phenomenon since fucking forever. I believe it's been centuries. And essentially, this Scottish folklore has brought Scotland so many damn tourists. It's insane. Like, literally, their tourism is booming, specifically because a lot of people come to see the Loch Ness Monster. Now, the Loch Ness Monster is said to reside in Highland, UK, and it's rather harmless from what I've seen. I've watched so many documentaries on this growing up as well, because I've always found it fascinating. They've even gave the Loch Ness Monster a nickname, which is Nessie. They say that Nessie is pretty shy, she's pretty reserved, and she's pretty nice. She's just really, really big. She has a very, very long neck and a very huge body, and she has green skin. And essentially, you know, she'll rub off on boats, or she'll just pop up like in the middle of the night. And lots of people who have been around the water in that area, which is the Loch Ness waters in the Highlands, have been either really, really mystified or really, really terrified. The Loch Ness waters are said to be about 23 miles and holds about 7 million cubic meter feet of water. So God knows what the fuck is in that water. But let us not forget to mention that scientists spent so much time digging up this water and essentially trying to find if there were any other human or any other beings in this water. Honestly, they didn't find anything. They did not find a Loch Ness Monster, especially considering the fact that the Loch Ness Monster is allegedly really huge. They have not found anything. However, they did discover about 5,000 new organisms in the water, but none of them were the Loch Ness Monster or monster like at all. There's been over 1,000 sightings of the Loch Ness Monster. I don't know if it's imagination, I don't know if it's just pure coincidence, but I don't know. When I found out that scientists actually sat there and, you know, scavenged through the water and actually only found certain types of organisms but none like the Loch Ness Monster, it definitely made me curious, but it also made me skeptical, because I feel like with a lot of these creatures and a lot of these animals and beings that we've never heard of, I feel like the governments are literally all in cahoots and don't want us to know about these things existing, mainly because of fear and just because of what we might do if we found out these things actually existed. So again, comment down below, real or not. The next one we're going to be talking about is goblins. Now, honestly, I always thought goblins were a TV, movie, Disney type of phenomenon. I never would have fucking thought that goblins are a thing that people have legitimately seen, taken pictures of, recorded, and so on and so forth. This shit is wicked. So a goblin is essentially a being or a creature that is basically here to wreak havoc on humankind. They are usually said to be very mischievous, very mean, very grumpy, you know, sometimes violent and deadly at most times. You guys most likely have heard about goblins forever, either in fairy tales or in literature. In particular, you know, European literature from back then, you see them reference goblins all of the time. You know, people talking to goblins, goblins doing housework, or this, that, and the third. And I feel like a lot of us kind of like brush it off as, oh, okay, goblins, they're not real. But in actuality, they just might be. Now, like I said, a lot of them are said to be mischievous, mean, and very unpleasant. However, there are a lot of goblins that are very nice and coexist with humans in a lot of the stories that we see. And this is said to actually be true, especially back in the day in real life. If you look at a lot of old architecture or a lot of old paintings and stuff, sometimes you'll catch a little goblin here and there. And these are supposed to be real paintings of real life scenarios. And it's always been interesting. It's like, how the fuck are all of these random beings and stuff like in these books or in these photos? And of course, you guys may chop it up to, okay, well, you know, niggas didn't have an imagination. Like, they didn't have Netflix. They couldn't chill back then. They had to do something to occupy their time. Absolutely. But it is a little weird because it's like, it'll be a real picture of a real event, but then, you know, like, you'll see a little this or a little that. And it's like, that's interesting. Did that really happen or not? Fiction or fantasy? Now, goblins are often compared to trolls specifically because of the way they look. Essentially, goblins are ugly, okay, really, really short in stature. Some of them have really, really long hair. Some of them have really long beards. But essentially, they look like little gremlins and stuff. You know, gremlins, trolls, goblins, actually all three different things. And yeah, they're not the same, but a lot of people kind of just throw them all in the same category. But in terms of goblins and trolls kind of live under bridges and stuff like that. Meanwhile, goblins kind of live in the mountains away from everyone, and they often come out at night to, you know, wreak havoc on everyone. Some goblins have even been said to be able to transform into humans, bruh. Yes, like shape-shifting goblins. There's different types of goblins, and we're gonna go over a few. Even though there's so many, we do not have enough time to do that. We're gonna go over some of the most common. So one of the main ones that you guys always see referenced is a kobold. Now, these are the ones that can indeed morph into humans. But sadly, in their human, and I believe in their troll form, they're like extremely hideous. They're really small as well. So I'm very sure a lot of us can probably spot out a goblin if we came across one, which I'm very sure none of us want to come across one. Then you have the hobgoblins. Now, I believe a lot of these are the ones that we see in Disney movies as well as just like, you know, mythical stories. These are usually pretty helpful goblins. They have dark, shaggy hair. They're often very, very helpful, you know, guiding humans through quests and tasks and stuff like that. Pretty friendly, pretty pleasant goblin. Now we have the knocker, which is very similar in terms of attitude, personality, and looks, but these live in the mines. Yes, so a lot of times there have been lots of stories of people who work in mines actually saying they've come across goblins. Y'all, shit is wild. And most of the time, they're pretty nice, they're pretty cool, and they're not gonna say anything to you unless you fuck with them down there in their home, which is the mines. But oftentimes, they're pretty nice and they're pretty helpful. Now, you have the Fuka, which actually takes the body and morphs into a black horse. Now, we kind of go into the bogey or the bougie type of goblins. Now, those are usually pretty hard to kill, and they're pretty mischievous and just fucking extra as all hell. So you kind of want to steer clear away from those. Then, of course, you have the murderous goblin, which is the red cap. The red cap has been depicted in a lot of literature, and essentially the reason it's called a red cap is because it wears a white cap drenched with the blood of its victims, and that cap is meant to give the goblin life. Y'all, I don't even have to tell y'all that if somehow you come across something that looked like that shit, you gotta run. Now you have the hobgoblin. Extremely friendly, very pleasant to be around. You got the Tengu, which this could be two of different things. I've heard of a lot of people say they're good luck. They're really, really respected and revered, especially in certain religions. They are said to be sacred and good luck. However, there have been lots of reports of Tengus actually stealing and kidnapping children. Tengus look like Chinese dog-like creatures and kind of look like a demon of some sort, but they are highly respected by Buddhists as the guardian spirits. For the most part, they usually take the form of a bird, but they can come in different forms as well. Very interesting. Goblins are kind of starting to sound like lugaus. Now we have the Kalikonstro. I can't really say it, but essentially this is a goblin that lives in water and also can be often compared to mermaids. Now these are extremely dangerous goblins. They're extremely terrifying, and of course, this does not just date back to back in the 18th or the 10th century in Europe and in literature. There's actually been a lot of sightings and stories about them in Zimbabwe, specifically in Africa, and other African countries as well. Now, definitely comment down below if you happen to be from Zimbabwe or any other country in Africa and have a story. I didn't get to dig that deep into it, but child, I couldn't read too much because it was getting late and I was getting kind of scared. Now I know how y'all felt. For those of y'all that clicked on my last video at night. They are said to be one of the most annoying goblins of all. In Britain, actually, they are said to break into people's homes at night and weave bad dreams in the ears of humans. Now, of course, last but not least, we have fairies. I never in a million years would have thought to look up if somehow, some way, fairies might be a real phenomenon. Until I was doing this video, I was like, you know what, let's see, are fairies real? Y'all, the rabbit hole I went down, you always see fairies all the damn time. They usually possess magical powers, as with goblins. Goblins are also said to have magical powers. And sometimes fairies and goblins are also intertwined. And sometimes people just call fairies, you know, really, really small goblins, or, you know, they call goblins really, really big fairies. Like, listen, lots of interchanging and shit going on there. Fairies are typically very, very small and they can disappear and reappear whenever they want. They have been rumored to be the spirits of those who are kind of stuck in purgatory. They have been said to be spirits that are essentially stuck on earth. They're not good enough for heaven, but they're not bad enough for hell, so they're kind of just stuck in between. And then you also have that group of people who believe that fairies are some sort of fallen angels and they're here to protect us. And of course, there is the theory that they are pre-Christian gods and goddesses that have been sent here or have always been here in order to protect the forests and the rivers. What's very interesting is back in the day, people had a very, very, very huge, like, obsession with fairies. Like, people who actually believed that they existed were so terrified of them and believed in them so much that they didn't even call them by their names. Like, they would not call them fairies, they would not call them anything. They'd just be like, oh, those things, that. And it's like, yikes, like, was it that bad? The earliest account of fairies was in England with the Gervas of Tilbury. Essentially, he had a fairy that would do housework and was just always out there looking out for him. Pretty nice fairy. These fairies were called brownies. This was back in the 10th century. Although Gervasi of Tilbury had a very helpful fairy, there's been lots of times where they haven't been too helpful and have been kind of like a menace or just very bothersome, kind of like how goblins are. So it makes me wonder, are goblins and fairies like the same thing and somehow people just separate them because they kind of look different? In Scotland, they're said to be very, very scary and people stay away from them. Meanwhile, there are fairies called banshees that actually only come around when there's bad news to be delivered. They're kind of like fortune tellers. They usually would come and deliver news like, oh, your husband's going to die, or your child's gonna die, or like, yeah, very fucked up, but yeah. Black Annis in Dane Hills, UK, as well as Annie of Scotland, have said to also be fairies. They're said to be Celtic goddess descendants of Danu, which is mother of the Ireland. Honestly, Ireland has the most interesting tradition, myth, and all that type of shit. Now, essentially, most sightings of fairies happen in the woods or near water. You don't ever really hear about them being like in regular areas, you know, like residential areas. It's mainly back in the woods or back where there's like not many people, and it's very interesting. There's been people saying, you know, they saw fairies pop up on their shoulder and disappear and appear on the other shoulder, or, you know, fairies helping people in crazy dire situations out of near death. For the most part, a lot of times there's a lot of fairies that actually look like humans, and for the most part they can actually reproduce with humans and marry humans. Yeah, it's insane. There's been a lot of stories of fairies actually going and kidnapping babies as well, and this is horrible, especially because if a fairy is your friend and does take you to the fairy world, or if a fairy decides to kidnap a human and takes them to the fairy world, they're not allowed to come back if they ate or drink anything there. So if they eat or drink anything there, they're stuck there like for the rest of their lives. So it's just very, very interesting and very scary to think about. And if one falls in love with a fairy, essentially, it's not that good for the human if it doesn't work out, because the only way out of that is death. Yes, death, ladies and gentlemen. The whole kidnapping babies things, it's wild. Usually fairies will kidnap a human baby if something's wrong with their own baby. So they'll take their baby, replace it with a human baby, and take the human baby back to fairyland. Now, a fairy may do this not only to strengthen their own stock, but as a double sacrifice in certain cases, depending on what you believe a fairy to be. And the only way to really get the baby back is to like either make the baby laugh or something like that, or to abuse it. It depends. And it's crazy because this has actually led to a lot of people being extremely like violent towards babies because they thought that their baby was kidnapped. Or listen, it's wild. Babies are often called changelings. Now, I'm sure you guys have read stories throughout history about this type of process as well. Fairies also don't have an afterlife. They don't have a soul, and when they die, they just perish. That's it. They die. They usually live pretty long, like a lot longer than humans. Even though they look like us and can do most of the same things we do, they live a lot longer, and like I said, they don't really have a soul or an afterlife at all. Yeah, that was a lot to unpack. Comment down below, do you believe in any of this? Is it fact or fantasy?